So, hi, Jonny. Can you just tell me a little bit about yourself and how you're involved in the creative arts on Teesside?
Yeah, I'm a screenwriter from Teesside. I live in Ingleby, Berwick, and I have done since I was 10. My first movie, certainly not my first screenplay, but my first movie that, like, movie credit, came out in America in October. I think it was October. No, it wasn't. That's a complete lie. It had its world premiere in August. It comes out in the UK in October, and it came out in March in the United States, just before COVID-19 kind of happened, really. But it was a digital release, so we weren't affected by cinema release or anything like that. And it was released by the Horror Collective in the United States, Canada, Europe, Brazil, India, Hong Kong. And it's called The Dirt, a horror movie, starring Richard Brake, who's out of Batman Begins, Game of Thrones, 31, Mandy, numerous other things. And Richard Short, who's in an American comedy drama called, TV show called Mary Kills People, and Bart Edwards out of The Witcher, and he was in Peep Show as well, along with Alexandra Evans and a young talented actor called Mitchell Norman. That came out then, and that's out in the United Kingdom in October via Lionsgate, mid-October. They're pushing for a release for then, just in time for Halloween. I did come on board as kind of like a polished writer on the new Arthur and Merlin Knights of Camelot movie, distributed by Signature Entertainment in the United States. I can't really take an awful lot of credit for that though, although my name is on the credits. But yeah, that was more of just a polish of various parts of the movie. So yeah, now we're hoping for a sequel of The Dare, and I'm waiting for feedback from my agent, who's in London, on my new sci-fi spec, which is a little bit like, I suppose, like Logan, you know, the X-Men movie Logan meets The Matrix. It's very much a father and daughter story set in a sci-fi world about a guy who can't escape his own dreams in order to save his daughter. So hopefully that'll be going out to certain producers in Los Angeles in the next couple of months. So that's kind of where I'm at the minute. But I have been writing for a long, long time.
Yeah, well, that I was going to say, I mean, well, what is the path that leads, you know, a young lad from Ingleby, Berwick to be a globally distributed horror film writer?
Yeah, well, it's a long, long story, but I always wrote stories when I was younger. I was obsessed with dinosaurs, and I had quite a wild imagination. So I wrote a lot of stories about dinosaurs between the age of 5 and 10. And then I saw Jurassic Park in the cinema as a 10-year-old, and it just sounds extreme, but it changed my life, really. I just couldn't believe. I'd been to the cinema before, to see Land Before Time, Ghostbusters 2. I'd seen, like, the, you know, other films at home, but Jurassic Park was really the turning point for me when wanting to make movies. And then from that moment, I was like making my own posters on like Amiga, paint and create, and putting movie posters and putting them on my wall. And I just became kind of obsessed with movies from that point. But even when I went to university, it wasn't because I wanted to be a screenwriter. When I got into adulthood and I got into the real world, my aim was to become a teacher of English. So I went to the university, went to Teesside Uni, did my degree.
How long ago was that? And what degree?
2002 or 2005. Graduated in 2005. Started a PGCE, but wasn't for me, and kind of just got into like going out, partying, and all of that kind of thing, which I did for a number of years. And then I thought, right, well, I'm going to do my master's degree. And just so happened that in 2009, Teesside Uni were doing a creative writing MA. And I started on that. And that's when I met Bob B. Green and Andy Willoughby and a guy called Andy Ross. I don't know what Andy's doing at the minute, but he was the screenwriting lecturer. And I really just sort of fell in love with screenwriting from that moment. So really long, long gap between when it was like a childhood dream, and then I did nothing about it until 2009. And I wish that I'd done a lot, started a lot earlier, to be fair. But even that's, it was still like 10 or 11 years ago now. And then I started writing and learned structure, sort of taught myself on nights, and was that library that's behind you, well, it's to your left on the picture. Yeah, I was in the library every night, getting like armfuls of books on screenwriting, and kind of just really soaked it up. I was like a sponge, and started to watch and deconstruct movies and all the old movies I loved. I started to learn how they were written, and learned about structure and character and theme. I still think about when I'm writing, I suppose I do sort of think about those lessons and those very early lessons, and remind myself of the craft and the early stages of learning that craft, and try not to let myself forget those early lessons, because they were really important. But from that moment on, I started just writing my own screenplays, and I wrote about three until I sent one to about 100 agents. Back then, you were sending letters to agents still on paper, and I went to Staples and got a printer and some quality paper, like that was going to make a difference. And I sent probably about 50 actual letters and about 75 emails, and 99% of them were coming back as rejections. But I'd put on the wrong postage stamp, so I was having to drive to the post office and pay like £2 or £3 a time, open the letter, and it was a rejection. I must have done this about 40 times. And then eventually I did, one agent just emailed me while I was at work and was like, I loved your script, could we have a chat? And then that was that. Luke Speed, his name was, he works for Curtis Brown now, but he got me a film deal with Giles Alderson, who'd read one of the scripts that I'd sent him earlier in the year, and he'd asked me to co-write The Dare with him, and then that's the rest history, really. I do have a different agent now, Sheila David, who works at Dali Anderson. But yeah, from like the first ever script I'd written, which Giles, who's the director of The Dare, had read, he sort of picked me up to co-write The Dare with him, based on one of his early ideas. And yeah, now it's out in all over the world.
That's brilliant. I mean, it's a great combination of, you know, that childhood inspiration, and then later a bit of formal training, and then just like the perseverance to go out there. It's hard to face rejection, particularly at such cost as well, but you know, it's clearly paid off for you, which I
I find that I get kind of motivated by rejection. I've got that integrity, I guess, where I get angry as a result, and that makes me want to do it more. And there's certainly a bit of delusion in there as well. I was a healthy dose of delusion at first, where I, you know, delusions of grandeur, thinking of where I would be in 5 years, which was just nonsense. But that delusion probably gave me the push to believe that it could actually happen.
Nothing wrong with pushing the idea out into the universe.
Exactly. And even now, though, you know, I've got two movies out in the by October, I've two movies out in the United Kingdom and United States and all of the world, and still time as a team leader in a drug search. So I'm not exactly a poster boy for achieving your dreams and living the glamorous life, but I'm happy with that. That's fine. I think if you get into screenwriting because you want to make a lot of money, then you're not in the right place. It might happen eventually, but it's more sort of the creative reward. And you know, we did the UK premiere of The Dare in Middlesbrough Cineworld on March 7th, a week before lockdown. And it was full. It was like 300 of my friends and family in there, and never forget it.
That's absolutely brilliant. I mean, I was going to come on to the lockdown question, and I was going to say that maybe writers have suffered a lot less than other people, but you know, if you're in that position where you've just released something and you're just, you know, having that kind of launch event is really important. And I know, you know, a lot of the writing business is going around and doing events if you want to sell things as much as anything. I guess maybe that doesn't apply so much as to screenwriters. But have there been positive, have there been negative effects of the lockdown on what you're doing?
Well, obviously the negatives are the incredible loss of life, and aside from all of that heartache that people have had to go through and all the suffering, it's awful. But in terms of the day, because it was in the United States and everywhere really, because it was a streaming release, I imagine people were in the homes more, so maybe more people watched it than they might have before. The studio is extremely happy with the numbers, and in a weird, ironic way, I suppose we can attribute that to the fact that there wasn't as many people leaving the house. I don't know. So potentially, you know, it was actually a blessing in disguise to an extent in terms of viewing numbers. But yeah, I mean, in terms of creativity, I think when it first started, there was a lot of anxiety, and it was like, oh, it felt like there was a wolf at your door constantly, and it was hard to focus and be creative. But I kind of just, for a lot of people, but for me, I kind of just escaped into my writing, and it allowed me to forget about all the awful things that were going on in the world. And I wrote Vivid, the sci-fi movie I was telling you about, during lockdown when it was at its height. So it'd be interesting to see if any kind of subconscious stuff filtered its way into that script. But it certainly, I wasn't so much inspired by the pandemic or anything like that, and I wanted to write a movie about people coming together rather than it being trying to draw on or capitalize on it. But for sure, I used it as an escaping tool.
Yeah. Well, I think that, you know, this is another thing that the arts does for us. You know, for it's not just about making it for a purpose of showing or exhibition. It's just the process in itself.
I've said a few times that I felt like I feel more impulsed to write. I think since I sent Vivid to my agent, this is probably one of the longer stretches I've gone without writing. But I don't know if that's because I needed a break. I'm in the middle of moving house, and I've got a toddler, and I've kind of just lost myself in other things. And I think that's probably a good thing, though. I see a lot of posts on Facebook about write every day, and I don't really prescribe to that. I've been there, and I made myself, you know, ill at one point. I think you really need to look after your own health and well-being first and foremost. Otherwise, you won't be there to write at all. So I think Absolutely. It's important to take breaks and look after yourself, and spend time with your family and your loved ones and your friends. And I think the pandemic's really shown that you can't just work flat out 24/7. I have a full-time job as well, 9 to 5 every Monday to Friday, and my own life to get on with as well. So I'll certainly look forward to getting back to writing when I get my notes back, but I'm enjoying the little bit of headspace at the minute.
Brilliant. Absolutely. Well, it's been fantastic talking to you, and I'll sort of badger you to join the Arts Lab. It would be great. People have suggested to me that there needs to be a kind of new, more informal kind of regular writing, like a social, but where we can each other and maybe.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah, I'm always up for anything like that, and you know, helping out locally or any which where I can. So, yeah, thank you so much for inviting me on, and yeah, look forward to seeing you again.
Thanks very much. Cheers.
Take care. See you later. Bye bye. Bye.